I once made a movie. It was intended to cause people to scream and yell, but I was horrified to find that some people took it seriously.
It was actually the first time in the history of movies where it wasn't safe to be in the movie theater.
When a moment of violence is so suggestive, so unlike anything you've seen, murder was now going to be an acceptable part of entertainment.
Psycho, you felt could happen to you. This was the first movie that showed you can be naked, alone in a shower, and someone who is going to come in and just stab you.
It had to be done impressionistically. The head, the feet, the hands.
He has broken the covenant of filmmaker and audience. And the audience cannot wait to see more.
Hello, and welcome to this Friday the 13th episode of Sean Kelly Interviews. Today we have my interview with Alexandre Philippe about his documentary 7852, which is all about the shower scene in Psycho. I did this interview at this year's Hot Docs, and it was actually an exclusive for patrons to my Patreon account since Hot Docs, but now it's going to be released to the public, and keep an eye out on Patreon for future exclusives. It will also support my writing and podcasting and stuff like that. So I think we'll just go straight into the interview, and I will see you afterwards.
What inspired you to make a film about the Psycho shower scene?
Well, you know, I mean, it's I think it's a culmination of a lifelong passion for me, you know, with Hitchcock and his work, and you know, kind of a scene that is, there's just no end to it. You know, you can spend 3 years of your life studying it and looking at it, and it just keeps, you know, it keeps showing you new things, and that's what's really exciting to me, is when you can look at a piece of work like this, and I just love this idea of something that you can't quite ever solve, you know, because the moment you solve it, then it loses kind of some of it, you know, its mystery. I don't think that's ever going to be the case with a shower scene. Okay.
So how long did it take the film to make?
The film took about 3 years to make, yeah. So it's a pretty long process.
Mm-hmm. So, like, what was the development process like?
You know, it was slow, and, you know, we got the budget sort of piecemeal, you know, because it was very difficult to convince people that, you know, we could actually make a feature about a scene. So we had to do, you know, a little bit at a time, you know, a few interviews here, a few interviews there, you know, some, you know, filming. Obviously, we had a lot of big set pieces like the Melons, like, you know, the opening at the Universal Lodge, and, you know, all of that stuff. That took a lot of doing and a lot of preparation. But, yeah, so it was a long process.
Yeah. Well, I think I first heard of the film when I, like, heard through a friend about an early cut that played a Fantasia.
Yeah, right. Well, it wasn't a full cut. It was more like a, kind of like a 30-minute...
Proof of concept,
exactly. Like, you know, it was like a 30-minute or 25-minute, you know, like, deconstruction sequence, you know, to show people that there was enough sort of meat on the bones, you know, as it were. And, yeah, the folks at Frontière were very, very supportive, actually, since the very beginning of this project, mm-hmm. Yeah.
So what was the process of deciding who you would interview for the film?
Well, you know, it was a mix. You know, for me, I obviously wanted to have both sort of, you know, the very established filmmakers and the younger generation of filmmakers, you know, to make sure that we could have that conversation, you know, between generations. I think that was very mm-hmm. important for me to show. Having a number of women, obviously, in the film is crucial. I think anytime you make a movie about Hitchcock, especially about the shower scene, I think that's very important. Editors, that was always going to be very key, you know, considering the importance of editing in that scene. And, you know, Walter Murch was the holy grail, you know, for me to get. So I'm very, very glad, and I feel very fortunate that we got, you know, to talk to him. So and then, of course, you know, beyond that, you know, people who were involved in the film. I mean, it's basically Marty Renfro is the only one at this point who's left alive. And also, you know, Hitchcock experts and scholars, you know, like Stephen Ribello, David Thompson, Bill Crone, you know, people like that.
I always kind of like related to like Guillermo del Toro's analysis, because I know that he's a big Hitchcock expert because he does like lectures here in Toronto sometimes.
Yes. Yeah right. And then, you know, he was another great catch, you know, that's for sure. Yeah.
Was there anybody you wished to get but you couldn't?
Yeah, many. I mean, you know, I went after Brian De Palma, went after William Friedkin, Martin Scorsese, David Lynch, you know, Quentin Tarantino. You know, most of them were just, it was just a scheduling issue. It just didn't happen. Some of them just didn't want to be in it, you know, so that's the way it goes.
So how do you feel 7852 differs from your other documentaries?
I think it's very different. It's a much more personal film. It's about a real sort of deep, deep passion that I have. I mean, I'm not saying that the other films are not passionate films. I mean, they really are.
Well, I've seen
but Hitchcock is... Yeah. So you know, Hitchcock is very, very meaningful to me. I think it's a lot more stylish as a film as well. You know, it has a lot more layers, I think, you know, to it. So just in the way that it was crafted, I think it had to be, you know, I approached it very differently, you know, and obviously the sort of whole sort of conceit of the film of, you know, giving the illusion that the interviewees are trapped inside the Bates Motel and the Bates house was, it was a tricky thing to accomplish, you know.
Some of those, you shot some reenactments for some.
Well, yeah. I mean, we shot not a full reenactment. It was more like I kind of see them really more as an homage. Well, there was the scene as, you know, Robert Bloch envisioned it, which is so different from the way that obviously Hitchcock ultimately shot it. That I thought it was an interesting experiment, you know, to try that. And then the opening, you know, sequence was obviously an homage to Marion driving in the rain, but it was also the way for me to bring the audience into the Bates Motel the way that obviously, you know, Hitchcock does in Psycho. So it's you have to lure them in there to hopefully keep them there for 90 minutes.
Well, I personally found the film quite interesting because I have a degree in film studies, so like I was actually taught to analyze films to the smallest detail. So
sure.
So I just am wondering if it was your goal to like use the film to like introduce like the general public to film studies and analysis and stuff like that.
I don't know that it's necessarily my goal. I think, you know, I think it's kind of a natural thing that's happening, obviously, as a result of this film. To me, it's I think the motivation is just more simple. It's about conveying my passion for, you know, for Hitchcock, for what he does, for the incredible people who worked with him. And, you know, to really bring attention and give a cinematic treatment to a scene that is just beyond exceptional, you know. But in a fun way. You know, I think it's a very different experience to watch a movie about a shower scene than to read a bunch of essays about the shower scene, you know. And I try to not be scholarly. And I'm not saying that as a pejorative term, you know. It's I really want to be accessible. I think the joy of deconstructing films is something that should be accessible, and, you know, to everybody, and that should be fun for everybody. And so hopefully this film kind of opens that up a little bit more, you know.
Well, there's definitely a big like contrast between some of the interviewees. Some are like giving kind of like scholarly analysis, and then others are like being very geeky. Like
that's right,
Elijah Wood in particular.
yeah, totally. Yeah, and that's exactly right. And that's I mean, that's exactly the feeling that I went after. You know, it's like of course there's some stuff that you have to look at very seriously, but to me, I wanted to make sure that there were those sort of light moments. You know, these moments of like just totally geeking out about the scene, these conversations, these moments of of laughter, of comedy. That's all part of the design.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, so during the Q&A the other night, you mentioned you were far from finished with the second shower scene. So what do you plan to do next?
Well, I don't know yet. I'm interviewing still a bunch of people about it, and I don't know if that will lead to another feature down the road or a series of shorts or, you know, a book. I don't know. What I know is that it's, I mean, obviously I have other film projects that I'm working on, but I'm exploring that deeper as a side project right now, and then we'll see where it goes. You know, I'm not going to put a time frame on it.
Yeah.
I'm just going to go with it and see what happens. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So, what's the general release plan for 1752?
So, in Canada,
I'll say that's coming out in Toronto in October.
Yeah, well, it's coming out in several theaters across Canada, actually, at that time. We have different distributors in different territories, mm-hmm. so we have different release plans. But I think they're coordinating with, you know, so IFC Midnight picked up the film for the U.S., so obviously they're going to be releasing around the same time. So in Toronto, we'll be at a TIFF Lightbox Theater in October. And I mean, I'm sure it's going to be in Vancouver, Montreal, mm-hmm. Calgary, you know, you name it. I mean, I think people who are interested in that can go to check out the Kino Smith website. That's mm-hmm. our distributor. Yeah.
Yeah. And so, are you concerned that people are going to be confused by the 1752 title? Because
yeah, of course, of course, of course. Yeah, I know. I get a lot of. I get a lot of hell from my distributors about that, but you know, I like it. I think it's a geeky title, and I think it reflects the geekiness of the film. You know, and to me, it also creates a mystery around it. It's like, what's that? You know, what are those numbers? What does that mean? You know?
Well, I was like, I want to press notes.
Yeah, right there, exactly. It's
78 camera setups, 52 shots.
Yeah. Right. Right. Yeah. Yeah, so, it's actually 78 setups and 52 cuts.
Cuts.
Yes, yeah. That's what it is, yeah.
Okay, so
that's it. Very good, so, thank you.
And that was my interview with Alexandre Philippe on 1752. As you probably heard in the interview, the film opens today at the TIFF Bell Lightbox. And I do recommend seeing the film, especially if you're a fan of Alfred Hitchcock's Psycho. And I should also note that I now have a Facebook page for this podcast, so you can go to facebook.com/skonmoviesinterviews to get a notification whenever a new interview posts. And that's all for today. I will be back sometime, hopefully before Halloween. I will try to get at least one more interview up. And I will see you next time.
Thank you.